Welcome to this session. We speak in French here? Yes. Not so many. So this talk will be in English, but in French English. Okay? I'm sorry for that. First thing I need to do is to take a picture because this audience is awesome. So I need you to smile, please, on the picture. This is super important. Yeah. If you are not in the middle of the room, I'm sorry. Cool. So let's talk about how you can add an advanced search engine to your existing application. This is the purpose of the talk, and this is basically based on my own experience. I used to work before Elastic for the French customs, and I had exactly this use case to implement, and so this is basically my story. Who does not know at all Elasticsearch here? Some people don't know Elasticsearch? Okay. So during the session, you can ask for questions on slido.com with the hashtag Elastic. And then at the end of the session, if I have enough time, I will answer to your question here. Or if I don't have enough time, then I will answer to those questions on Twitter. So slido.com, hashtag Elastic, if you have questions. At Elastic, we are building open source stack named Elastic Stack, which is composed by Elasticsearch. So Elasticsearch is the core of the stack. It's a search engine where you send JSON document over a REST API, and then you are able to search for those documents in a really fast manner. And you can scale horizontally, add more nodes, deal with petabytes of data if you wish. So it's really performant. You can add on top of this Kibana. So those are the two products that we are going to see today. So Kibana helps you to build nice user interface and also play with Elasticsearch, like running curl commands, but more easily on Elasticsearch. We have also ingest layer composed by Bits and Logstash. Bits are agents. Logstash is more an ETL tool. So all this stack is open source. On top of it, to make money, Elastic, the company, is providing XPack. So XPack is a set of advanced features that you can put on your Elastic stack, open source stack. It adds security, alerting, monitoring, reporting, graph exploration, and machine learning nowadays. And we are also providing Elastic Search as a service and Kibana as a service in the cloud with the cloud.elastic.co, where you can deploy your stack on AWS or Google Compute Engine, or Google Compute Platform, sorry, or also on Azure, which is coming next. So I'm David Filato. I'm Dadoune on Twitter. If you follow me, then I will share with you at the end of the talk the link to the repository that I'm going to use and to start with. Where is this, my repository? Oh, I forgot to open it. So let's open it. So it's this one. So if you go to this repository, you are by default in the first branch, which is 00 legacy. This is where we are going to start from. So you have all the explanation. It's running with Maven. It's using MySQL database here in my case. And then you have all the instruction here. And then I'm going to do some live coding during this session, and you can basically understand what I'm doing by comparing every single branch with the legacy one or with the previous one. So everything is explained in the different branches. For example, if you go to the first step that we are going to do, then you have the explanation how to start with Docker Compose or manually, for example, Elasticsearch, and then do the stuff. So just follow the guide. And that's all. So I will tweet about this later. So let's start. We have an application running here. So it's running locally on my laptop. The use case for this application is about person. I'm storing person in a database, and I want to provide a search engine on top of that to search for those people. If what I need to do for now, if I'm searching, I don't have anything because I did not insert anything. So I have this interface which is calling a REST endpoint in my application, and this is going to generate 10,000 random persons in the database. So this is what we have for now. So it's going. And then I can start to search. So for everything here, I can start to search for people like Joe. Okay, it's working. Let's have a look a bit at the implementation that we have. So we have four bins here. This is the left part of the screen. We have a person bin, which contains the name, the date of birth, the gender, the children, and also an address, which is linked to that, which contains the country and the city, and the location also, geopoint, latitude and longitude, that we are not using for the SQL-based search for now, and also some marketing data. If we look at the schema that we have in the database, so I'm using Hibernate behind the scene here, the schema is super close, so we have a table for person, a table for address, and a table for marketing data. Basically, this is what we have. So if we look a bit at the code, if I'm looking at the person service, so anytime I want to add someone in the database, I'm calling this save method in the person service layer, where I'm starting a Hibernate transaction, then I'm saving my entity to the database, and then I'm committing this transaction. This is basically what I'm doing. When I'm searching, here I'm coming from the interface, and I'm searching for something, and then I'm calling like this DAO class. And this DAO class has this method, find like Google. This is basically what we have, a simple input box. And I'm searching for whatever the user has entered, using Hibernate again, generating a query with that. So what is the implementation? It's super naive here. So I'm using a like person strategy, and I'm doing a join with the address table because I have two tables here. And I'm searching for whatever the user has entered inside the name field or inside the address.country field or address.city field. Okay, super basic thing. If we look at our search engine, we have also the advanced search here. So advanced, okay, not that advanced, but I can search specifically for some fields. Like I can search for Joe, living in France, living in Paris, for example. Okay, so how is that implemented so far? If we look at the person service here. So I'm doing something super similar. From the interface, I'm getting the name, the country, and the city values. And if I have anything in the name field, then I'm doing a like again, but this time only on the name field. If I have a country, then I'm doing that on the address.country and address.city. So it's pretty much trivial what we are doing here. And it seems to work fine. So actually, why should I change? So let's do some other searches. So I'm searching for Joe, it's working well. Joe Smith, okay. Searching for Smith, Joe, oh. I don't have any result anymore. Why this? Because it does not match what we have in the database, right? So I can solve that. I can probably split the terms that the user has entered and then compare each terms with the database, but that's not something I want to do for now. I told you that I can search in different fields like Paris, I can search for France. There is something bad here. Can you see it? Yeah, so France is the name of the country. Yes, that's okay. I have this woman. I don't know if you know France Gall. France Gall was a famous singer in France. So what is the problem here? France Gall is coming on the second position in the list. I think that for my use case, France is a very rare term in the name field, and I would expect it to be on the top of the list, right? France as a city, as a country, is super common thing. So here, I'm getting the results back as they have been inserted inside the database. And this is not what I want to have. So let's do something else. Let's search for, oh, I'm doing a typo. GSMOF. Okay, I can't do that. Maybe I can try to replace all the letter with a question mark and try to do all the combination as possible in the SQL query, but it will not scale at all, right? So those are the reasons I want to use a search engine to fix all that. And obviously, I want to use the best search engine ever, which is Elasticsearch, but I'm biased. I'm working at Elastic, I told you. So the question is now, how you want to send the data to Elasticsearch? So you can use an ETL tool like Talend or Mule ESB, for example, where you can say, okay, every 5 minutes, I'm going to run a query. I'm going to convert the result into a JSON document, and I will send that to Elasticsearch. Okay, that might work. But what happens if my user click on the save button in my application? It means that I will have to wait for 5 minutes before this information is searchable. So probably I don't want to do that. I prefer to have kind of real-time things. And there is a more tricky part, which is to deal with updates, for example. When I'm updating an entity in my database, what should I do on the next run? Should I get again the full database and reindex everything? Should I get only the difference? So to get the difference, probably I need to store in my table a technical date value to say, okay, I modified this entity, so I need to read it again. What about deletes? When you run the batch again, you have to remove something which is not coming back because it's not anymore available in the database. So how you deal with that? So it's super tricky. You can do that by using maybe a specific technical table to manage that. Or maybe you need to use a trigger, but okay, that's not what I prefer. So my advice, and this is what we are going to do, is that if you have access to the application which is generating the data in the same transaction as you are sending the data to the database, then send it to Elasticsearch. And this is basically what we are going to do. So let's do that. So the first thing I need to do is to add, obviously, Elasticsearch. So bear with me. I just updated this night to the latest version of Elasticsearch that we released yesterday. So let's hope that everything is going to be smooth. So I'm going to use here the 6.2.0 version of Elasticsearch. What I said that in the save method, within the same transaction where I'm saving an entity in the database, I'm going to call Elasticsearch here. So let's create an Elasticsearch DAO class. I need to implement a save method and save this entity. So we need to create that field. So it will be a final Elasticsearch DAO, which I need to create. It's super small on my screen, and I'm getting old as well. So I'm using here a project name RESTX. So RESTX is kind of Spring Boot framework. So I'm going to annotate this as a component, so it will be injected kind of automatically here. So I can add in the constructor parameter. Yes. OK. So I have my Elasticsearch DAO here. And now I can implement this save method. So let's save a person. So what I need to have to be able to save an entity, a Java bean inside Elasticsearch. The first thing I need to have is a way to convert my entities to JSON documents because Elasticsearch only speaks JSON. Right? So to do that, I'm going to use the library named Jackson, which is super handy for that. So I'm going to use an object mapper from Jackson, and which I'm going to add as a constructor parameter, why not? And I'm going to inject that here. This is already provided by the RESTX framework. I need something else. I need to add here an Elasticsearch client. So my Elasticsearch client, I never remember the name of the class. I'm getting old, as I told you. This is the REST high-level client. This is it, ES client. And I need to build it. So let's initialize it here. Let's do that here. So So basically what I'm saying, I'm creating what we call a low-level client here, a low-level client builder. By default, Elasticsearch will run locally and will listen to on this port, 9200. This is the default. And then I'm wrapping this builder inside a REST high-level client, which is giving me more features. I can mark this one as final as well. That will be it. Okay. So I have everything I need here. So the first thing I need to do is to convert my entity to a JSON document. So let's do that here. So I can write that as bytes or as a string, as you wish. Oops. Okay. So this is my JSON document, so my bytes. And then, why is this? No, it can be void here. And then what I need to do, I need to send that to Elasticsearch. So I'm going to use the client. I'm going to call the index method. I'm going to provide an index request object here. So here I can specify what is the index name. So I'm going to store all my person documents inside an index name person. The type of the document, this is something that we are going to remove in the future, so don't worry about that. And here I'm going to use the ID that has been generated by Hibernate as a string. And I need also to provide the document itself, so the source. So I can pass the bytes here, and I need to say it's a JSON content. Okay, exception. So basically, with those two lines of code, I'm able to send something inside Elasticsearch and index something inside Elasticsearch. So not that hard. Let's compile that. Okay, we can have an exception here, right? Maybe something can go wrong with Elasticsearch, why not? And we need to deal with that information. So let's do something like this, try catch. So I'm going to write pseudocode. This is not exactly what I would write in real life, but you can imagine. We can say, okay, I have something bad with the Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is not a transactional system. So maybe what I should do is to roll back the current transaction and don't insert the data in the database, right? You can do that, but when I was working at the French Customs, I decided to do that another way because it was super important for me when the user click on the save button in the application, whatever is happening on the search engine part, I want to save the data in the database. That's more important than the search engine part, right? So what I did, something like this, error, Houston, we have a problem. And then I was warning my team that something was going wrong. Actually, I did not implement it exactly that way. I was sending that to a message queue system, and then I was able to replay all that event that has been sent to the message queue system when Elasticsearch is back, for example. So, okay, that's okay, we can do that. I mentioned the delete operation. When you delete the data in the database, where is that? Here. Maybe we can also call Elasticsearch at this exact moment and say, let's remove a document knowing is ID. Okay. So let's implement that method. Void, and this is the ID. So how I call Elasticsearch with that? It's pretty much straightforward. You call the delete method with a delete request. And what are the coordinates of the document? The index name, the type, and the ID. And then exception. Okay, so pretty easy. So let's compile that. I'm almost done. I need a super important piece here. I need to start Elasticsearch. I don't have Elasticsearch running yet. So I wrote a Docker Compose a file. So basically, I'm using here Elasticsearch, the latest version. So this is coming from our official repository. And I'm giving some settings. I don't want to use machine learning security or what have you, for example. And then I'm also providing a Kibana instance. So let's start Docker. So it will take some time. So Elasticsearch is going to start. It's going to expose the 9200 port where we can send the REST request. And Kibana is also going to start and connect to this REST endpoint, which will allow me to have a nice interface. So let's... Can you cross the fingers with me, please? Okay. Let's see. So I'm going to open Kibana and check if it's running. Not yet. Sometime it can take some time. Mm-hmm. Here we go. Awesome. So this is the latest version of Kibana, by the way. So I'm not going to use this interface for now. I'm just going to go through the dev console. In the dev console, I can run like curl commands, like get slash, and I can see that my Elasticsearch is running and is answering. If I look at this API, underscore cat indices, and I'm looking for a person index, I have nothing for now, of course. I did not index anything yet. So let's restart the application and see how it goes. I need you to cross the finger again. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's running. Let's index again. Let's send some documents in the database. So I'm going to send only 1,000. We'll see how it works. So for now, you can see that we have that number of documents without Elasticsearch. So let's see what happens. It's much slower. Okay, not that good, but we will see if we can fix that later. But if we look at the Kibana console and start again the same query, then we can see that we have our documents coming. I can do a simple search. Here, what I'm running is a match all query, which means give me everything that you have. So I can see that I have that number of documents. And this is one of the documents. By the way, which is strange, why this ID? I don't understand. Okay. Oh, this is the ID generated by Ibanet, probably. I don't know. Whatever. So here, you can see the JSON representation of my document. It contains anything that I need, like the name, as I said, the date of birth, the gender, the address with the country field and the city field. Okay. Do I have all my data? Yes, I have my data. But still, when we are using the interface, I did not modify the interface yet, so I'm still using the database for searching now. So we need to fix that. To do that, I'm going to change the person service layer, which is here, and this search method that I have. I'm going to remove the old code. And I'm going to build here a query builder. This is a query. And let's say that the user strings is empty, did not enter anything as a query. Then the query I want to build on Elasticsearch child is query builders is a match all query. This is what I mean before. Okay, give me all the results that you have. Otherwise, I want to build another kind of query, which is query builders again. And I want to use what we call here the multi-match query. We have plenty of queries, but I'm going to use this one. So what is the user searching for? For Q, in which field the user is searching? The user is searching in the name field. I said country dot, oh sorry, address dot country and address dot city. By default with Elasticsearch, everything is indexed, which means that I can search also in the gender field if I wish, like this. Okay, so I have a query. Next step, call the Elasticsearch DAO. We need to implement a search method, pass the query, and I will show you how you can deal with pagination. It's super straightforward, so let's pass those parameters as well. And let's implement this method. Okay. I'm going to call the Elasticsearch client again, this time with a search method. And I'm going to use a new search request. By default, if you don't set anything as a parameter here, it will search across all the indices that you have. But here I want to narrow on only one index. You can use wildcard if you wish. If you have multiple index starting with person, you can do something like this. So I'm going to search in the person index. And then I'm going to provide a source, what's the name? Source search builder. No parameter here. And just I'm going to add the exception here. Okay. And on this search source builder, I'm going to provide the query that I prepared before. And for pagination, just from and size parameter, and that's all. So super easy. Okay. So with that, I can search for something. So let's get back the response and let's return the response object. Okay. So in my here in my method, I have this response object. And my application is not that legacy. I'm not using struts or those old frameworks. I'm using AngularJS, if I recall correctly. So I'm cheating just a bit. I'm just going to send back the response object as a JSON document to the interface, basically. Okay, so I'm done for the search part. I'm going to do the same thing for the advanced search. And I'm going to type super fast. That's it. Okay, so what I'm doing here, if the user did not enter anything in the name field or the country field or the city field, then run a match all query. Otherwise, if he enter anything in the name field, then so we are going to create what we call a Boolean query. And if the user enter anything in the name field, it must match on the name field. If he enter anything in the country field, it must match on the address.country field, and so on and so forth. Okay. And I'm calling the same method, Elasticsearch DAO search. So I need to restart. Yeah, for now I have to restart. It's Java. No, you are changing methods. Yeah. So let's hope that it works. So now I'm using Elasticsearch behind the scene. So you can see I have the match all query. I'm searching for Joe. Does not work. But GO, the full term, is working. Okay. Can I search for male? Yes, but only the full term. Okay. France. Oh, look, France is in the first position now. Awesome. We have a relevant, we have some implemented relevancy in the search feature that we want to offer to our users, which is great. What can I do? I can search for, okay, the full term. So only full terms are working, not part of the term, but this is something we have to fix. So we have two things to fix, this, and we have another thing to fix, this. Okay, this is super slow. So let's start with this one. Why is that super slow? It's super slow because for every single document that you want to index, you send a HTTP request to Elasticsearch and then get the result back. One request, get the result back. It's super slow. So we have a really much nicer API to do that. And the API is named Bulk. And to implement that, we have in Java a Bulk processor class, which is super handy. Let me create that. So this class, basically, I'm going to add a request to the bulk processor. And what I'm saying here is that every 10,000 action, flush the bulk to Elasticsearch. So index 10,000 operation per 10,000. And then, whatever the number of operations you have stored in the bulk, every 5 seconds here, flush the bulk. This is basically what I'm doing. So I need to change that. Instead of calling the index operation, I need to call the bulk processor, and I need to add this request. And you can do that as well for the delete request. So I'm not going to restart now, but we will see the effect later. I want to first, before restarting, to understand why when I was running query with subterms, it was not working as I would expect. So to do that, so if I'm searching for Joe, I repeat, G-O, it's not working. Why this? I need to explain some of the internals of Elasticsearch. By default, if you don't tell anything to Elasticsearch, Elasticsearch will automatically generate a schema out of the data that you are sending to Elasticsearch, and maybe it's not doing the right thing for your use case. So here, this is a default schema. What Elasticsearch is doing, for example, let's have a look at the name field. It's saying that name is a text field, and it's going to be indexed using what we call the default analyzer, the standard analyzer. What this analyzer is doing at index time, you have this nice underscore analyze API to understand all the details. If I have a text like, can I edit that? Yeah, G.O. Smith, like this, with the standard analyzer, this will produce 2 tokens. And those 2 tokens are going to be indexed into the inverted index. So we are using Lucene behind the scene. So we are going to index Joe, this term, and Smith into the inverted index. And when we are searching, for example, if we are searching for G-O, this is my case, G-O is going to go through the same analyzer by default, and G-O is going to become G-O lowercase. That's all. When I try to compare that with the inverted index, G-O is not equal to G-O-E. That's the reason it does not match, right? And this is something I want to fix. How you can fix that? Oops, I'm sorry. You can fix that by using your specific analyzer that you want to use. So this is an example. I'm going to create a text index, and I'm defining an analyzer, which is an n-gram-based analyzer, and I'm just going to explain what this is going to produce. If I'm trying to analyze the same Joe Smith text using this n-gram analyzer, then this is what is going to be produced. So G, G-O, G-O-E, S, S-M, etc. Which means that when I'm searching with Joe, Joe is now in the inverted index. So I will be able to retrieve my documents. On the other side, I will generate more tokens, more space on disk. But you have to pay a price at some point. So I want to solve my use case, and I want to solve it in an efficient manner. So what you could do is to remove the index here. So I'm just throw all the data. And you can define your mapping or new settings like this. So define the analyzer and then apply this analyzer to the mapping. Instead of doing that manually, here I'm going to use a library that I wrote. The name is Beyonder, so it's available on my GitHub account. You can use that or not, so it's as you wish. So what this thing is going to do, it's going to basically look in your class path for some given directory name and look if you have some data inside. So I'm going to show you. So I need to pass here a low-level client to this one and do a try-catch. So I'm just calling Beyonder here. And then if I'm adding anything, sorry, oh, too wide, okay, new directory. If I have a directory named Elasticsearch, then Beyonder by default will look inside this directory. And if I have another directory name something, that will be the index name. So Beyonder is going to create an index. And here you can provide a file name underscore settings.json. And this file will be automatically sent to Elasticsearch when the index is created. So I'm going to pass, where is my cursor? Yeah. Mm-hmm. I can't edit this file. That's bad.
Not valid JSON.
Yes, I did not enter anything yet.
Exactly, that's why it's red.
Yeah. But I want to edit something. What did I do? I don't know. Okay. So let's compare that with a branch. This is what I told you. If you use this, hopefully. No. Interesting. Let's try again. Otherwise, I will do that manually. Settings.json. Yes. Or maybe I did not paste anything. Oh. Yeah. Oof. Yeah, I'm back. So, I don't know what happened. So here I define the analyzer that I shown you before, but also I'm setting the mapping. And what I'm saying, let's have a look at the name field. What I'm saying that by default, you are going to use the same strategy for the name field. I'm not changing the analyzer for the name field. But at index time, you will generate and you will copy the content of the name field to another field named full text. And if I look at this field, full text, here I'm saying that I'm going to use this n-gram strategy that I just mentioned. And I'm doing the same thing for address.city. I'm copying the content to full text, but also I'm creating at index time subfields for the address.city. So one of the subfields is address.city.autocomplete, where I'm using also the same n-gram strategy. And I will also generate a ags subfield name, which is a type of keyword which helps me to do sorting and aggregation. So this is what I want to do. So hopefully I can restart, and now in debug mode. I remove the index, which was important. Is that okay? Starting. If I see positive message like rock and roll, then it means that everything is okay. So I can have a look at the mapping. Okay, Beyonder did his thing. I have all the mapping that I need. So let's reindex some data now. Let's reindex 1,000. Why not? It's okay. So it's a bit faster, not that fast, but a bit faster than it was. And then now, can I search for something like, oh, it does not work. Why this? Because I'm still searching in the name field, right? I did not change the search part yet. So I'm still using the old strategy. So I need to change that. If I'm looking here, instead of searching in name, gender, country, city, what have you, then I'm going to search in the full text field. Okay. What I can do, I can also do something more interesting, which is I can still search also in the name field, sorry, in the name field. But if it match on the name field, I want to boost the result, which means that the name field is much more important for my use case. Whoa, my English is gone, if it was there. So let's compile that again. So if I'm searching now for G-O-E, okay, it's working now, okay? Let's search for France is on the top of the list, okay? So I have subterms, it's working fine. Search for here G-O, it's not working. Why this? We are still searching in the old field. So instead of searching in the name field, we can search now in the name, in the field name autocomplete, so which is the subfield generated at index time. Same for country, same for city. If I'm searching here for GO, living in France, living in Paris. Okay, we are back. Okay, so we have implemented the use case as we wanted to have it. Let's have a look a bit at this. So this is not a high throughput in terms of indexing document in Elasticsearch. So let's do a simple test. In the person service here, in the save method, I'm going to remove the call to the database. And I'm just going to call Elasticsearch in that case. I need to change something because I'm not going to provide the ID anymore because it's not generated by Hibernate. So I'm going to just call, ask Elasticsearch to generate the ID for me. So it's reloaded. So let's 10,000. Okay, done. So let's do 1 million documents now. So probably Elasticsearch is not going to slow down your process, right? When you index in Elasticsearch, it must be super fast. I'm just running everything locally here in a Docker container, so it's not that fast, but it can be much faster than that without Docker here, on Mac, I mean. So, but still, okay. So this is faster, fast, super fast. And while we are indexing, it's a search engine, so you can search in a very efficient manner whatever the field is, you see, okay. Even the advanced search in France. So it's a search engine, it's built for that. It's built to be fast. Okay, can we do more? You want to see more? Yes. Oui, okay, oui, thank you. So let's do something else. We are going to add what we call an aggregation. So here, I'm going to add here, I'm going to compute some things on the result set. So the first thing I want to do, I want to compute what is the distribution of my result set broken by this field, address.country.ags. So I want to have, it's like a group by count ordered by the first values. So that will be the name of my aggregation. And then I want to create another one. I want to build a date histogram aggregation on this field, the date of birth. And I want to compute a bucket for every year and basically count the number of documents I have per year. Okay? So let's do that. So obviously, I have everything ready in the interface. So now if I'm searching for my result set, so you can see the result of the aggregation here, right? You have here the distribution per country and the distribution per 10 years. Okay, and if I'm searching inside this data set, it's super fast, you can get the distribution of the result set here. Okay. We can implement something more interesting, which is a facet in, oh, by the way, the injection of the 1 million documents is over now. So we can implement what we call the faceted navigation pattern. Let's say that I want to click here on France and filter the result set. I want to help my user to navigate inside the result set, whatever the name is. So for example, it's not implemented, but I need to implement that. So to do that, I'm going to go to the person service again. If you noticed previously here, you can see that I have those things coming from the interface. So this is the filter by country or the filter by year. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to add filters like this. I'm going to say, if you have a filter by country or a filter by date, then you are going to build a Boolean query again, which must match what the user has entered before. And also, if the user has set anything as a filter by a country, then you need to filter the result set using this term query on this field and whatever the user has entered. And same for the date. This is, by the way, a way to do range queries on dates or numbers or what have you. So here I'm doing a range query on a date of birth field on what the user has entered plus 10 years, which is computed here. So let's do that. I think I can do it. So I can search for people living in France in the 50s, starting and name Joe. Okay? Can we do more? Yes. Do you want to see more?
Yeah.
Well, awesome. So we can build with Elasticsearch aggregation of aggregation of aggregation, like a tree of aggregation to do advanced computation. Like, I'm still doing the first level of aggregation, which is I want to break by country, but then for each country, I want to break the result set per country per 10 years. And then for each bucket of 10 years, I want to compute what is the average number of children. Okay. So I'm going to do that, and I'm going to change the interface. Look, I'm super good at HTML. Okay. I wrote this code, so. So now I have this compute button, and I can see the result of this distribution of data. So I have that number of people living in England, that number of people born in the 14th year, and they have that number of children in average. So if I'm searching for Joe, now I can understand what my data set is about, and then have the result set here. Okay, I have one more thing to fix, I think, which is here. Let's search for GSMOF. Can I fix that? It's a search engine, so I hope so. So what we can do here, we can implement in this method, in this query, sorry, we can add for a fuzziness factor. Like, I'm allowing one edit distance, which means one letter has been added, one letter has been removed, one letter has been replaced by another, here in my result. So I can do that here. 3 minutes left, so that's okay. So if I'm searching for GSMOF, okay, I have now my result set. I can do that, I'm sorry, for the advanced search as well. So G is not working yet, but I can apply this fuzziness factor to also the match query here, country and city. Not yet. So, G, Pyrrhus, France, Pyrrhus, Pris. Okay, working. Okay, one thing left. So I have Kibana, and with Kibana I can create an index pattern here to do some visualization after. So let's create this index pattern, next step. And the time-based data is date of birth, okay. And I don't have time to create visualization by hand, so I'm going to just import some visualization that I did already. So here, yes, override, confirm. Okay, so I have dashboards, what have you, all the data. So with Kibana, you can basically search for things like in 1940 to 2010. Yeah. So you have the distribution of the result set. So this is the date histogram that you can visualize now. But I built a dashboard, a nice dashboard for that. So this is something that you can do for free. Everything that I'm showing you here is open source, right? So here I have that number of people, so some kind of visualization, even including geolocation point, for example, and the result set. So now I can search for my Joe. And this is the distribution of my Joe. I can search for Joe who are women. So I can do filter and navigation. I can search for all women living in France. and living in Cergy Pontoise, this is the city I'm coming from. And if I zoom in, okay, so this is a random layer. Can I zoom in a bit? Yeah. So I'm living nearby here. So I can also filter and select all the people living in this area. So it's like a dating system, right? I now have all the women living nearby me. And because my wife is using the same system, I'm going to negate this. And I said, no, I don't want to see my wife or friends. I just want to see the others. Okay, I think I'm running out of time. Yes, I'm done. Thank you so much for attending the session. I will look at the question if you have any question, or just ping me. I have stickers here. And have fun. Bye.